Amazing.
We're gonna get back on track, but just to stay off track a little bit longer, I have to ask you this: the fidget spinner kind of fad that came and went. Well, I think it's gone. What drove that? Like, was that something that you guys can anticipate, those kind of trends coming in and out?
You're quite 99% of the time, 98% of the time, you can't anticipate a big fad like that. And that's more a fad than a trend. So it's something that goes like that and then goes back as fast. If when you spot it, you've got the right kind of factories and the right kind of infrastructure to be able to jump on that bandwagon and ride it, fantastic, and you can make a lot of money. But the money is often lost when you call the end of the cycle incorrectly, a bit like stocks and shares, I suppose. So it's okay calling it on the up and making a lot of money, but if you hold on too long and it turns out to be a fad and drops off very quick, you could have container loads of toys.
Right.
Still coming in.
Yeah.
And then you can't give them away. And that's the thing with a toy. You have to have somebody somewhere that wants it. And the second they stop wanting it, it's not even worth giving it away for free to the toy shops, because the toy shops say, but I could put products on that shelf that kids will want to buy. Whereas if I put your toys that are now out of fashion, out of fad, they won't move at all. You're just taking up space.
We talk a lot at the foundation about building resilience in young entrepreneurs. And as an entrepreneur yourself, we're now talking about, obviously, we'll come on to your story as well. But in terms of resilience of products, what has been, is there a type of product, a type of toy that you've seen has a huge longevity to it, where kids come back and back and back for it?
Yeah, I like that question a lot, because it's a conundrum that many companies like mine in the toy industry have always tried to figure out. You know, why has one toy made it and stayed the distance, and why has another one that looks equally as good just fizzled out? And I remember meeting Hasbro, the big toy company, for the first time in America, and being welcomed into this ginormous showroom where they were entertaining the inventor community.
Right.
And my company was not strictly an inventor company. We were manufacturing our own product, but we had done a deal with Hasbro that year, and the product had been very successful. And we got an award, a lovely award, 2014, Hasbro's Inventor Team of the Year. And it was for a six-legged, walking, Nerf-blasting, dart-firing robot.
Nice.
And the sales lasted about 2 years, and then it fizzled out. The Nerf brand continues and continued to grow and get stronger. Sometimes a product can fizzle out, but the brand can remain. And if you look at a lot of those brands, they continue to pump a lot of money behind them to keep them in the minds of the consumer. When you first launch a product, I'd almost go as far as to say no amount of advertising is really going to get you going. You've got to have an incredibly good toy, and a lot of the launch is about great PR and publicity.
Mm-hmm.
Once you reach that position as a leader with that product, it's then your job to ensure it stays there, and that's when advertising really does come into its own. But you've got to keep that. And what you're really doing is you're building a bridge away from your closest competitors. And when you're spending that amount of money, because you're getting that amount of revenue, and you keep putting a big amount of the revenue that you're getting back into advertising, you keep yourself almost in a castle with a moat around it, and you keep your competitors at bay, mm-hmm. who can't quite get across that moat. They can't, unless they come up with something so uniquely different but in the same category, you will stay as the brand leader and they will stay on the outside of the moat.
Interesting. So compared to all other industries, you'd say toys has an argument to make as being the one where the brand is the most important. Products will come and go.
Well, I'd say today every company, if they're not focused on their brand, is is going to be short, is relatively short-lived. And by short-lived, yes, it might go on for 10 years or 15 years, but very long-term will be short-lived. Because as consumers, we buy things that have a meaning to us. You know, a brand, in its purest sense, is a promise. So it's a promise to the customer that it's going to deliver on a set number of values, you know, whether it be Coca-Cola, you know, the taste and the refreshing piece, whether it be an Apple iPhone that's probably more synonymous with the word cool than anything else, perhaps as a brand value. It's always got to deliver on that promise. And you break that promise and you'll start to see brand erosion and then you'll lose sales. And I think in the toy industry, we're very product focused. We come out with lots of innovation and sometimes we forget about the brand and the promise. So you'll come out with a product that has got a certain attribute that makes it wonderful. But because we're made up of lots of inventors, not necessarily brand or marketing experts, we then go on to the next shiny idea and think, forgetting to build out that product into a brand and understand what the values were of that product that you've just created, and do they extend into other areas? Or can you double down on that product and bring out a Mark II and a Mark III and then extend its life? So lots of clever ideas, people, but like all businesses, you know, they or industries, they tend to have more of one thing than another. In our case, it's more inventive.